your name?
Tom Picard.
Tom?
Yeah.
With an American accent from?
Yeah, Texas originally.
Texas. How'd you know the show?
I've been coming here off and on for about 9 years.
To Perth?
To Perth particularly, because yeah. I like it. It's a small town, but a big. It's clean, it's small, and yet it's everything's accessible.
Yeah, know? Like a good city should be.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, there are not many good cities anymore.
Not many left. Sydney used to be good.
Yeah,
well, got a bit big now.
Yeah, well, you know, there's 10 guys for every guy in Sydney. But anyway, I'm coming over here. I'd love to live here forever. If I ever find a wife, I will.
Yeah.
If I can get her to marry me, it'd be.
Hello. I'm Andrew. You're far away.
Get in the frame.
Hi, I'm Sonia.
Sonia, Andrew. Hi. Hi.
Anyway.
Why have you been, when you say you've been coming here for 9 years?
Well, I'm a professional magician. I've been on the road for almost 32 years, living in Europe, Switzerland, Holland, Belgium, all over Europe. Yeah. And the States today, there's like, just in LA alone, there's 6,000 guys that do magic. And so I'm 51 years old. I don't want to wait in line for the rest of my life. I'm a close-up manipulator.
Oh,
I'm a manipulator. Cards, coins, cigarettes. This sort of thing. Can you get a close-up?
Seen all this before.
Well, you're seeing it again. Yeah, that's for you. Oh, you dropped
it. Thank you.
Anyway, that's...
And you do table?
I do table. I'm a street performer. I'm European champion this year. I won the championships in Belgium.
Congratulations. Well,
thanks. It was fun, but it was challenging, too. There were 28 acts from Holland, from Belgium, from France, from Germany, and I went up against them and beat him, and I was the only Yank, so they love me now.
How did you meet Tom?
He comes into my work all the time, so.
What is that?
Yeah, Vino Vino's in Northbridge. But I'm a professional singer, so.
Right, so you have show business in common.
Mm. Yes, we do.
Yeah?
We do, yeah.
How long have you known Tom?
About 20 minutes. No.
20 minutes, no. About a month?
About a month, I suppose.
Which is the same thing in life.
Yeah,
really. It is, yeah.
So just on this trip, you met Sonia on this trip?
On this trip,
yeah. Yeah. And you're a singer, you say you... Where are you working?
At the moment, I'm working on originals and hopefully launching them next year. So, see how we go. And I'm off to the States next year in May, so I'll try my luck over there.
Right. Are you going to be there?
For me in the States? No, I'm in Europe. I'm in Europe.
You work mostly in Europe?
All the time.
All the time.
Yeah, I do a lot of the rock and roll festivals over there, the open air shows.
Mm-hmm.
It's good money. It's fun. I'm backstage with James Brown, Willie DeVille, In Excess, all the big name acts, and
tell
doing
me,
my
you,
tricks for
me. How did you do small magic in a big
on a big
venue?
Show? Like, well, I'm doing close up. I'm doing backstage. I'm just entertaining the people backstage, and I'm doing it out for the people out in the crowds. They pay me, so.
Right. Tell us about where you got started in this.
I started as a drummer, back when I was about 14 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I played with magic when I was 11, 12, and then I gave it up, went to drumming. And then I realized later on girls didn't like magicians, they like musicians, so I got into the music business real fast. And I wound up playing and touring on the road after the Army, after I was in service. I toured with quite a few semi-famous bands in the States, and I kept running into magicians every place I went. I kept running, and then when I was in New York, I joined the Brotherhood and met Slidini, and he started, and I took later, I went back after I quit the bands and took lessons from him, and it was like probably one of the greatest close-up magicians ever to live. He passed away a few years ago, but he was a genius, a real creative genius.
And do you think he was the one that inspired you?
He would definitely, because I was a magic shop guy until that point. I had been going to the magic shops buying the gag things that were already made and everything, but Slidini taught me how to use my mind, my hands, and my body, and no gimmicks, just my abilities, and that's something that a lot of magicians lack today. It seems to be in Vegas especially, it seems to be a big contest of who's got the biggest trick and who can vanish an airplane, who can, and it's gotten ridiculous, and it needs to get back to the skill and the learning and the spending the time to develop magic, you know.
Yeah. What do you think is the attraction of magic?
Well, for me, it's the time consumption of learning to let my hands do something that they haven't never done before, and for the audience, it's just the fun of seeing it, making it look real, you know. Try to anyway.
Mm. You think
I used to be psychic, but I gave it up when I realized it wasn't all that I predicted it would be.
And you obviously write your own material.
All the time.
Tom, what about your personal life in all of this?
What about it? Well, it suffered a lot because I think I sacrificed, I guess, settling down and having a family to stay in this business. And so I'm more or less married to the business. And, it's difficult to find a lady to travel and live. Because I'm used to, I could live in a tree house, and next day you could put me in the Sheraton. It wouldn't matter. But I wouldn't want to drag somebody along. So I never married, and I never...
So you've been...
You know, but of course, that could change.
You've been on the road quite a lot.
Since 1970.
Is it something that you're now so used to that you don't want to stop? Or?
No, I'm looking now to settle in someplace like, say, Perth.
Where you get your visa card?
Where I get my permanent residency would be fine and be nice. Being a Yank and being 51, I don't know what my complications are going to be, but if I find a nice lady, maybe that'll help.
Yeah. You know. Would you say, literally, settle down and do something else?
Because you. No, I wouldn't do anything else. I would just settle in and work on the creating the prop. Right now, I'm starting to work on things that'll be sold later on.
Yeah.
I'm working on a book. I just built my website. I didn't even know what computer was 2 years ago. Now I have a full-on website. So that was fun learning. I taught myself computer.
Yep.
Taught myself the HTML and how to do everything. And
so you're not afraid of
learning?
Learning new things.
No, life is a learning experience. I learn something every day. Yep. And every magician and every performer I've ever seen, I've learned something from.
Let me ask you a really tough
probably
question.
Probably a composite of everyone. Yes, go ahead.
I mean, after all this time, you've been on your own and traveling, and you know.
It's lonely and boring.
But do you think there is room? Could you accommodate somebody else in your life?
Oh, yes. Definitely.
Could you make that change?
Oh, sure.
So you could.
Will you marry me? No, just kidding. I'm not that way. I used to be that way.
I'm not sure if I'm that patient.
I could be that way again. No.
Second, can we intrude on your Saturday morning shoe shopping? We're from SBS. We're doing a documentary about people around Australia, just at random.
Yeah.
Are you seriously interested in buying a pair of shoes?
I am. Seriously interested in my husband buying a pair of shoes.
Ah, I see. Yeah. You like shopping?
Love a shop.
Yes.
You like shopping?
Not particularly, unless I've got something particular to buy.
Can I safely assume that you're married?
Yes. You can. Yes.
Have you been married long?
9 years.
9 years.
Does it feel long?
Pleasantly long, yes.
Right. Tell us about how you met and how it came about.
Oh, my goodness. Many, many years ago, when my brother worked with Barry.
Years ago.
Yes. And it wasn't exactly what you call whirlwind romance. But we became best friends.
Uh-huh. That was like a long time ago.
76.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then did you not have a...
Didn't see much of each other for quite a number of years.
We didn't live very close to one another.
Right.
Yeah.
And then what changed? Something changed.
Bumped each other again and things went on from there.
Right. Mm. And that was about 9-10 years ago.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah.
Married in 90.
Did you make a formal proposal to her?
Yes.
My word, yes.
Yes.
On your knee, everything?
No, it wasn't on my knee. It was after dinner at a restaurant.
Did you know it was coming?
No.
No?
No. I didn't. No, we were actually going to wonder whether we were going to have a little rest from one another.
All right.
I was going to suggest that we had a rest from one another.
Why was that?
So that we could rethink.
I see.
I think you weren't sure where it was going or whether it was going.
Right. So when Barry popped the question, what was your response?
I knew it was right.
So the doubts disappeared?
Yeah, they disappeared, yeah. And I just felt fine. And
how long after that did you get married?
It was about 8 months.
Yes.
9 months.
Yeah. Yes.
Sorry, you were going to say?
Yeah. I was going to say, I remember where we'd been prior to going to the restaurant.
Where was that?
Must you?
Where?
A sewerage treatment works.
I was managing a sewage treatment plant at the time, and I had to call there that night. It was a problem, so called on the way.
Now, you've been married 9 years. Mm-hmm. Do you have any children?
No. A bit late for that.
Too late for that?
Yeah.
So tell us a bit about your life before Roma, before you got married. In those wilderness years.
In wilderness years? Oh, I don't know about wilderness. Fairly busy with work and fairly heavily involved in local church.
Yeah.
And a couple of years in national service and a couple of years in New Guinea. Different things. So.
Vietnam.
Yes. Yeah. So all that time you were you weren't aware of a relationship blooming, even though you knew each other.
No. Well, not for all of that time, but. No, it wasn't. It wasn't.
How was your life before you got married?
Busy. Yeah. Yes, I was teaching for many years, and I was very involved in local church too, in different one. And also, I had many lovely men friends as well as friends, and so I wasn't really lonely.
Right. But I was wondering whether the change, you know, because I mean, you weren't 22 when you got married,
No.
The change from being single to married, how did you adjust?
I think we're both fairly unusual because we were both still living at home with our families.
Mm-hmm.
And I had two sisters still at home then and still one with my parents.
Yes.
And I think that helps to, you know, rub the corners off.
Right, so you weren't living,
off and
you weren't living on your own.
Yeah. Living on our own.
So we weren't allowed to get too self-centred.
Yeah,
exactly.
Right. Did you agree on what you wanted to live in?
No.
What
we found a good compromise.
I wanted to live in a very old home and do it up, and Barry was keen on getting something that didn't fall down. So we made a compromise and got a very conventional, what would you call it, conservative, colonial sort of home.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was conventional enough for me and not too old for Barry.
A workable compromise.
Very good.
So this is one of the things that you negotiated. I mean,
yes.
Are there other things that...
Oh, same thing applied with...
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, one is buying a lounge suite and the style of that.
Yes.
We looked for month.
Yeah.
And eventually, we come to a good compromise on all those things.
Yeah, we're very happy with it. Yeah.
You were saying you were both involved in different churches.
Mm-hmm.
Were they different denominations?
Yes.
Now, how did you solve that one?
Well... I felt very strongly that Barry had moved from one side of the Sydney to come over to my side of Sydney, so I felt it was only right that I should compromise and go to his church. And so we actually we went to a different one, but his denomination. Yes.
All right. What are the are they very different?
Not totally. Not the same though.
My name's Andrew.
Yeah.
We're meeting people around Australia and finding out what they look like behind their sunglasses. And what they do and where they're going, and I won't keep you long.
Okay, no worries.
What's your name?
I'm Peter Connell.
Peter.
Yep.
What do you do?
I'm a school teacher.
What do you teach?
Maths and computing.
And what do you do when you don't teach?
Either play soccer or do something else, go to the pub, something like that.
Yeah, something social.
Yeah, yeah, something social, yeah.
Do you have family?
No, not in town. Yeah. If you mean by family, wife and children, no.
Yeah. You don't have a wife and children?
No. From about my third year of uni, I decided that once I was out teaching, I'd do my best to get back here.
Right.
Yeah.
Do you know why?
Well, I like the people that are here.
Yes.
And the people that I live with at the moment, I've known them since uni, so having a good time with them. And soccer's a pretty much a ruling light in my life, and there's a very good soccer competition here too. So
you play soccer? Have you played soccer?
Yeah, I've played soccer since I was about 10.
What do you play?
I'm a goalkeeper.
And how many goals have you let through this season?
Oh, God, I don't know. A few too many to remember, I'm afraid.
I would have thought you could have counted them on one hand.
No, too many.
Soccer occupies your life?
Mostly, yeah.
You're not married?
No.
You don't want to be?
No.
That's it.
No,
that's
too much responsibility.
That was another part of the plan, was it?
Yeah.
Early on.
Yeah, too much responsibility to get married and far too much responsibility to have children at this stage, yeah.
Now, I don't want to jump to conclusions, but does that mean you like to be irresponsible?
A little bit sometimes, but within limits.
Yeah.
Like, not so much that it hurts anyone else. But I think a little bit of irresponsibility can be fun sometimes, yeah.
So basically, I mean, if I can put it this way, it's like a selfish decision on your part.
Yes, it is.
Because it works for you.
Yeah, it does.
I don't mean that unkindly.
Yeah, no, I know that. Yeah. No, that's fine.
So what are you share a house?
I share a house, yeah. One of my flatmates just bought a house, so I've moved in with him now.
Right. And how does that dynamic work?
Works very well. We work well together.
Are you similar people?
Yeah, we are. He plays soccer with me. We actually go down to Sydney every weekend and play soccer as well as playing soccer here on the weekend. So
you're married to soccer, really?
Yeah, we do like soccer a lot, yeah.
With all of this goes a sense of fun, I presume?
Yep,
you share your sense of humour with your flatmates?
A little bit too much, they'd say sometimes, but yeah.
Meaning what?
Yeah, I do. My sense of humour is a bit cheeky and sometimes a bit naughty, and some people get grossed out by it.
Do they? What sort of things do you do? Go and tell us. Shock us.
I can't. You put me on the spot. I can't really think of anything I can.
Do you play tricks on people?
Oh yeah, all the time. Always play tricks on people if you can.
Yeah.
You know, the glow in the dark mask is always a good thing, or the spider that pops down from the ceiling is a really good one, especially for the girls.
Yeah, you do that.
Oh yeah, yeah, I love that.
No, we're getting warmer. You've done these. What about, you know, plastic frog in the toilet?
No, I've never done anything like that.
I didn't want to give you any ideas.
No, I don't. I do like picking on people that have a lot of stuffed toys. I like picking on their stuffed toys. So
what do you do with that?
I'll kidnap the toys, especially if I'm going on holiday, and send back photos of the toy, that sort of thing.
Do you send back ears of the toy?
No, never pull the toy
You're
apart.
Not unkind.
No. Maybe dress it up in, you know, whips and chains or something, but never to damage it. Yeah. No.
Do you demand ransom?
Sometimes.
And you get it?
No, I've never got it. The most I've ever gotten is a schooner of beer, but that was worth it.
And you enjoyed the schooner?
Yeah.
If you go down in the woods today, you're sure of a big surprise. If you go down in the woods today, you'd better go in disguise. For every bear that ever there was will gather there for certain, because today's the day the teddy bears have their picnic.
My name's Andrew. What's yours?
Paul.
Paul. What's...
She's shy.
Shy.
Yeah.
What's her name?
Danae.
Danine.
Danae.
Danine.
Renee with a D.
Oh, Renee. Danae.
Yeah.
And she's your girlfriend?
Fiance.
Yes? Yeah. You're going to get married?
Yeah, next year in March. Yeah.
Already set?
Already set, March 18.
Yeah. When did you ask her?
In February.
Uh-huh.
February, yeah.
How long have you known her?
A fair while.
So what made you pop the question?
Oh, it was just the right thing to do.
It was the right time?
Right time.
How did you do it?
I was at the casino, actually, where we just went up there and, I had it planned for a fair while and actually had some number plates with my last initial on it and gave them to her and said, how about get married? And she said, yeah. So I'm going
to
do it.
Did she have a card to put them on?
yeah, she did, but yeah, it's probably not right to put them on yet, so wait till we get...
So that was a novel way of asking her.
Something different.
Did she pick it up straight away?
Oh, yeah, she saw it and just, it was great.
What did she say?
I started crying and, it's great. Fantastic.
And you had the ring?
Didn't have the ring. I thought that's probably more like
later on.
Something she should pick out.
I see.
Yeah.
And has she?
Yep, picked it out. She's got it on now, so.
Terrific. Yeah. She's very shy.
Yeah, she's a bit shy. I think she should come in here.
But what else, tell us a bit about her before she gets here.
Oh, she's great.
Yeah? How did you meet her?
Actually at McDonald's. Yeah, she's...
She was working there?
She was working there and a bit of a fast food freak. And,
So you went in, but how did you actually manage to ask her out?
Actually a sister. I was... had an unusual name as well, and I just said to her, I said, oh, that's an unusual name. She said, oh, everyone in family's got unusual names. And I said, oh, yeah, what are they? And she said, oh, Danae. And I said, oh, right, that's her, is it?
Yeah.
I said, oh, he's my best friend. Yeah, anyway, so, that's how we got introduced.
And where did you take her first?
Oh, just to a nice restaurant for dinner and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Not a fast food.
not a fast food restaurant, no.
What do you do?
I work at a pet food company.
Yeah. Doing what?
Oh, just whatever they ask me to do, basically. Yeah.
What other jobs have you had?
Oh, that's basically it. I've worked there for about 7 years.
Now, you said you planned how you're going to ask Denis to marry you.
Yeah.
But everything else you don't plan, right?
Yeah, that's basically right, yeah. I just, I'm a pretty big believer in fate, like whatever happens, happens for a reason, so yeah. Like me running into you today probably happened for a reason.
For a reason, yeah. When you say fate, you mean the universe or a person up there?
I think there's got to be someone up there, orchestrating it all. It's like, you know, being an actor in a big play, really. I think the script's already written out and you're just, you know, going to go down your path no matter what. So.
Have you got a good script so far?
It's certainly an amazing story, I think. But, so.
Why is that?
Oh, just all sorts of different things have happened to me and whatever. So.
Good things?
Oh, a bit of everything, really. Mm-hmm. So, but it's sort of like changed me as a person.
Things like what, for example?
Just different things. Like, I was adopted, so that was a pretty big thing for me. And that, as it stands now, like I'm in the process of finding my birth parents and that now. Biological parents, I should say. And
And the family that adopted you, when did they tell you that you were adopted?
Oh, I've always known since I was very young, so it hasn't been too hard for me to handle or whatever. Right. So, yeah.
And how close do you think you are to finding your.
Oh, I've actually found her.
Oh, you have?
But she's over in New Zealand, but it's taking a little bit longer than what I thought. It's. One of those things that's a little bit hard for some people to come to terms with, but you know.
You've written to her.
I've written to her. Danae has actually spoken to her, and I've read about these sort of things. Sometimes they just take time or whatever. So
that's a big thing for you.
It is a big thing. I always thought, like going through my life, you know. I didn't really need to find out, but it's like a jigsaw puzzle I need to find to complete the whole set,
What about your dad? Do you know anything about him?
No, that's the thing. I don't know anything about him, and to find him, I've got to go through her.
Yeah.
As it stands, like with birth certificates and that, back in those days, I never ever put the man's name on it, so that was a little bit.
Where were you born?
In Australia. Yeah, he's from England and she's from New Zealand, so. Yeah.
Right.
But hopefully, like, that's probably my goal, I suppose, to find them. Yeah. So.
What did when Danae spoke to her? What did she say to you about her?
What did Danae say about her?
About your mum? Yeah.
Obviously she was blown out about the whole thing. Like when you know, I think we both were like when Danae got off the phone. Like all of us were just sitting down in shock.
Who made
the
call?
Oh, Danae did.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, because we tracked it down on the internet, and that's how it all happened.
Yeah. So, there is hope.
There is hope. There, like, I'm one of those people. I never give up. So, yeah. It's not over yet. Yeah.